Internet, la web y los buscadores forman una parte cada vez más importante de nuestras vidas. Hoy vamos a hablar con Yevgeny Gavrilovich, un investigador senior de la empresa Google. Él está trabajando en los temas de procesamiento del lenguaje natural. Cómo lograr que una computadora entienda el significado de un texto y de esa manera entender qué es lo que estamos queriendo buscar y darnos los resultados correctos. So, Yevgeny, thank you very much for your time and for being here.
Thank you very much for inviting me.
Sure. You were born in Russia, you studied computer science in Israel, and now you work for an IT company in the US, and you both had positions in academia and in industry. So my first question would be, how do you compare, or what are the pros and cons of being, for example, a researcher at the university, being a technical employee at an IT company, or being a researcher at an IT company?
So I had a fairly unusual career path because I studied for undergraduate and master's degrees, and then I thought I'm done with my academic studies, and I went to work for 5 years. So I worked for a big Nasdaq traded company doing signal processing, and then I worked for a startup doing web search. And it was 2001, and I figured out I want to stay in this field. Web search seemed very interesting, and I want to eventually end up in a research lab. But I felt I need to acquire more academic background to be able to develop new algorithms and promote the state of the art. So I went back to school and I worked for my PhD. And then I got back to the industry.
How do you collaborate with universities? For example, at some point you bring researchers from universities to the company, or you might go for some time to a university to continue your work?
Yeah, we actually do both. So Google, as many other companies who are doing research, have significant outreach to universities. So what we do is we invite professors to submit applications for grants, similar to applications they submit to government agencies. We review those with a panel of experts, and then some of those applications are funded. And what it allows the researcher to do is they're receiving unrestricted grants, they're spending them on their graduate students and attending conferences promoting their research. And it does help a lot to foster collaboration between us, the industry researchers, and the professors and their students. Now, other things we do is we're participating in conferences, like I'm attending ICHCAI here in Argentina. We are attending campus events and we're giving talks at universities. We also have intern programs which run every year. So last year I had 6 interns from different universities at my group. This year I had a few more. And another important thing I would mention is we have university professors spending time with us. Could be spending a few months on a part-time basis, could be spending a year or a year and a half sabbatical. So I had 2 professors working with me in my group spending sabbaticals, one from NYU and one from the University of Washington. It was amazingly productive time. We built a new crowdsourcing platform that was published at WWF last year, and it was very fruitful collaboration.
You work at Google, and without revealing any secrets, I'm going to ask you some basic questions about search, for example. So when we search for something on the web, of course, most of the times there are many results to be shown, many times millions of results. So how do search engines decide what to show first?
So we are trying to show what people are searching for and what would be relevant to their requests and what they would find interesting. When we talk about relevance, it's an information retrieval term. It is what the user would like to read given a particular query. Queries are usually short, they're just a few words. Sometimes people ask long questions, just the way you would ask me. Sometimes the queries are very short. There is an interesting challenge here to understand what you really meant by asking this particular query. Then what the search engine does is, first and foremost, it looks for documents on the web, web pages, which contain the same or similar words. Because we believe that if you search for a combination of words, those words are likely to be found in relevant documents. Then we are also trying to prefer a document that other people who search for the topic found useful. So if you think about PageRank, which is a classical algorithm for finding documents which are popular on a particular topic, we would surface, or we would prefer to show those first.
Great. So there seems to be now some battle between, you know, web pages and search engines. So web pages are trying to show first, and search engines are trying to make sure that they show the correct results. So can you describe a little bit how that dynamics, you know, between the web pages trying to go up and search engines trying to show the correct results?
Yeah, so what we are actually trying to do is we are trying to mimic users. We are trying to devise algorithms in such a way that people will find results we show useful. So we have panels of users internally who would evaluate the search engine. They would run multiple queries, they would see the results, and they would label them as relevant or irrelevant, or useful and not useful. And we would design our algorithms in such a way that we would rank more useful results first, because what we really want to do is we want to delight the users. The Google's mission is to make the world's information accessible and available to everyone, and really make sure that the information we find in response to your request would be useful.
Great. So I'm curious about, how does an expert on the web use the web? Do you use the web in any way that you would describe as different from the way normal people use the web?
I think being a web expert allows me to usually search faster and to get to results with fewer queries. In my personal life, I find it amusing that my 8-year-old son is already using the web very productively. They're trained to use web-based documents to write a report for school. When he does his homework, he says, "Okay, Google, find me this result." And by the way, it should be easy. So it's very funny to see that he uses Google in his homework every day.
So you have this young kid, and of course he's now in school, and so there's some impact, of course, of the web on education, and a lot of people are putting pressure on the education system, saying, "Hey, all the facts are on the web. We shouldn't be teaching our kids facts. Maybe we should teach them, or we should help them develop some skills." For example, one of the skills would be how to search in the web. How do you view this process of the web impacting education?
So I think the web does definitely impact education. I think what the web does, it democratizes information access. It is infinitely easier today to find relevant information. When I was a kid and I was assigned to write a report in my biology class, I remember my dad took me to a library. He worked for the Academy of Sciences in the Soviet Union, and they had a library of the Academy of Sciences. He took me there for several days, and I spent several hours. Today, I would use the web, right? I would use a search engine. So it is infinitely more accessible today. Talking about skills, I had this very thought myself, because my son's school brags about promoting web skills and teaching kids to use the web. I'm actually not sure how much time I would love them to spend on teaching web skills, because when in 2015 my son just observes me and my wife searching the web and using the web, I think he picks the skills just right. What I would love to do is not to teach kids specific skills like those. I want to teach them to think, because I think skills are good in some circumstances, skills are very specific. I would like to teach kids how to think, and I hope it will generalize in multiple scenarios and will make them versatile enough. They will be able to think on their feet in multiple cases and situations.
Right. So I saw there's now a new computer, for example, by Amazon, that is like a small cylinder that you have at home. It doesn't have a screen, it doesn't have a keyboard, it doesn't have a mouse. You just talk to it. It goes for the web for the answer. Do you think those devices will become more and more pervasive at our homes?
Yes, absolutely. I think it's an amazing trend to make computers understand humans as other humans understand each other. And I think it's extremely important to get it right from the privacy perspective. We at Google are thinking very hard about privacy and putting people's privacy first. So, for example, when you talk to your computer, it should not proactively upload your speech to the server to analyze before you make an explicit request that you're asking for help. And we're always thinking about how to do it right privacy-wise. But that said, yes, I think it's an amazing tool. I can ask Google what the weather will be like tomorrow. I can ask the Google app in a kitchen, give me a good recipe. Or I really liked steaks here in Argentina. I assume when I will go back, I will ask for, okay, Google, tell me how to prepare a steak.
Great. So we're now getting a little bit closer to your research topic. Can you describe what natural language processing is?
Yes, natural language processing is the science of making computers understand human language. And when I say human language, it's languages we humans use in our everyday life. Could be Spanish, could be English, Russian, Chinese, and so on.
So what are some of the challenges there? Because it's really hard for computers to understand some subtleties of the language. Can you describe some of the things that are very difficult for a computer to understand?
Yes, human language is notoriously difficult to understand. Even my own native language, Russian, seemed to me extremely simple until I started to teach my kid Russian properly, and suddenly I discovered many exceptions that I was aware of, but I didn't think they make it difficult to understand the language because it's my native language. I barely think about it, I just speak. For computers, the two main problems in natural language processing are polysemy and synonymy, and I will explain those terms. Polysemy is about a word having multiple senses. For example, we say in English bank. It could be a banking institution where you have a banking account, where you withdraw money, or it could be a riverbank. And when you say in your query bank, the computer needs to somehow know what you're talking about. Usually, we people understand it from context. You don't just say bank, you say a longer sentence or utterance or phrase, and your part of the conversation will understand what you meant by the context. The other problem is synonymy, and it's the problem of the same sense or meaning can be expressed with multiple words. For example, some scientists writing a paper about brain will use the word brain, and others will use cortex. And we want the computers to be able to understand that those are similar or related words. So when I search for the word brain and you wrote an article about the cortex, I would love to retrieve your document, even though it's written in an entirely different way with different words. But it talks about the same things I'm searching for.
Oh, and how far are we from, so this is probably a long path, right, to make sure we get to a, point where can be similar, a computer can be similar to a human in terms of how much they understand. How far would you say we are there, and what are the next steps that we have to move on?
So on the one hand, we made terrific progress in the last years. I think some of the main advances in natural language processing were the availability of the vast computational power we could use today, and the availability of large amounts of knowledge, like Wikipedia, for example, that we use often. And it's an argument I tried to make yesterday in my talk at EachKai, is that the more we know already, the easier it is for us to acquire more knowledge and consequently to understand text. Because we know more about events and entities, and we have more knowledge, similar knowledge that you and I have about the world. So in artificial intelligence, we would usually call it background knowledge or encyclopedic knowledge about the world.
Okay, so on the web, we not only have documents and web pages, now we have more and more videos. How far are we from being able to extract, you know, the text from what someone says in a video and be able to search on that? So for example, if I'm searching for the word brain, not only to look for the documents that have that word, but also for videos where someone is saying the word brain.
I think it's a very interesting challenge. It would be terrific to understand the speech and text and videos to make them accessible to people who are searching for those. I think it's a notoriously difficult problem because in a typical video you'll have not a well-positioned microphone like the one we have here in the studio. We'll have a microphone far away. We'll have multiple noises. A car would pass nearby, a dog would bark. You would have multiple people talking at the same time, what we usually describe as speaker separation. We need to distinguish between two people speaking, and we need to understand exactly what each one said. So it's a very difficult problem. So my colleagues in Google are making good progress in this direction, but it's much more difficult than to say, understand what one person says at the microphone. Think about the Google app. You would say, okay, Google, please help with such and such request, and Google will deliver because you're a single person talking clearly to your microphone.
I wanted to go now to your topic of research. You're working in knowledge discovery. What is it?
Knowledge discovery is a very broad term. We are trying to find new and interesting facts on the internet such that it would be interesting to show them in search results. So for example, I would travel to Argentina and I might ask about the capital of the country. I might search Google for facts about Argentina, about the language spoken here. And all those facts we store in a structure we call a knowledge graph. A knowledge graph is often referred to a knowledge base or a knowledge repository. It contains entities or things in the world, cities, capitals, people, and we have facts about those entities. When we talk about facts, we usually view them as relations between two entities. For example, Albert Einstein was born in the city of Ulm in Germany, and there is a relation between them, which is place of birth. And we're trying to find such facts on the internet, and what it actually means is we are trying to read the web, and we are trying to understand the pages and discover such facts and store them so that we can later use them to help users.
Okay, so when you find those facts, you store them where, and later can you retrieve those facts? How do you do that?
So we store them in the knowledge graph, which is a very big repository of knowledge. Again, it has entities or objects or things in the world, and we have relevant facts about them. When we store them, when we retrieve those based on user request, it sounds like a simple thing, we just fetch the fact. What happens under the hood is a multi-step process. Think about the user issuing a query to Google. We need to receive the query, we need to understand the words, make sense of the phrases and idioms and expressions. We need to understand what the user meant, which entities from the knowledge graph might be relevant to the request, and then we fetch those entities and facts about them.
So, but of course the landscape of jobs is changing a lot. What would you recommend to young people thinking about their careers in the future? What do you think would be a good recommendation for them in terms of how things will change?
Well, I would definitely like to see more people in science and engineering. So to achieve this goal, I think it would be great for them to get more technological education, basic physics, basic math, and I think it will equip them very well for the future.
Okay, so talking about the future, your company, the company where you work now, Google, has many fascinating projects. Which of those, for example, in robotics or in health, which of those projects that you see around, you know, catch your interest or you would like to, you know, for them to do very well?
Probably all of them. And I really want to make a positive impact on humans' lives. We are understanding the world around us to some degree. I would love to understand it better. So yes, it would be terrific to make progress in education, progress in healthcare. It would be terrific to make progress in robotics, and it would be terrific to offer users assistance in various circumstances and situations.
Great. Evgeny, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you very much for inviting me. Muchas gracias.